God in our lives, in our minds, in our hearts. So I want to just invite us quickly, because what I'm going to share is going to be somewhat brief. But what I want to invite us into is into a space where we begin to take our eyes off of our own power and what we think we can control, and put our eyes and our focus on the one who controls it all. One of the words that I feel like God's really been pushing me, even in the works of justice and ministry that we do, is that we really do not have the power to make any change. I know some of us just need to sit with that for a minute. That the power of real change comes through the flow and the move of the Holy Spirit. And if we don't get ourselves into the flow and the move of the Holy Spirit, then we will end up in situations where we are using and expending a lot of energy to try to create things that we can measure, but may not necessarily be actually moving in the rhythms of what God is trying to do. So as I was trying to, I was actually initially going to preach one of the Be the Church series today. And I feel like the Spirit wouldn't let me. I was trying to work with content. I was trying to work with scriptures. And I said, I'm trying to work this thing out, and this thing isn't happening. And then I felt this thing in my spirit where God said, because I'm not going to allow you to do your business as usual. And the only word that he kept bringing to me was the word, get the hell out. That's what I said. I said, Lord, why are you cussing me out? What does this mean? But when the Lord began to drive into my spirit, is that until we get the hell out of ourselves, the forces of demonic energy, the brokenness, the pain, the burdens that we've been carrying, but until we get this out of us, we will not be able to step forward into the promised land of God in our lives. And I want to say to you with deep love and deep compassion that I believe what God is calling for is not for zombies, which are people who look like they're alive, who dress like they're alive, who know how to function in society, but yet are people who are not alive by way of the Spirit. But I feel that what the Spirit of God would say to us today is, are you willing to allow me to make myself alive in you in ways that challenge you at the core of who you are? Are you willing to allow the move of my Spirit to drive out all of the hell that is inside of you? Because before you can effectively confront the hell in the world, the Spirit wants to affect the hell inside of you. Because it's a different kind of humility and a different kind of sacrifice, a different kind of brokenness. And the Spirit says, I am calling from you. Oh, you're not going to be able to do this the way that you want to do it.
Spirit.
Very powerful work, but also very powerful worship. and boldness and courage. I want to read this scripture for you. Ephesians 6 verses 10, and the writer says, finally, be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. I want us to hear this. Somebody needs to hear this today. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. As physical as it feels like our struggle is, the fact that we actually have faces and uniforms and realities and relationships that personify our struggle. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood. The enemy would love us to believe that our struggle is with people. Because when we believe our struggle is with people, we stop fighting the real enemy. And when we believe our struggle is with people, we try to use human means to push back those forces. But when you recognize that the struggle is not against flesh and blood, when you recognize it's not with people, then you recognize the power of saying, Spirit, break us. When you recognize that it's not with people, but that we actually need the Spirit of God to break down some walls inside ourselves and inside others. Well, what breaks that down? I was reading another passage this week where Jesus was coming down from the mountain. His disciples were with a young man who was throwing himself in and out of the fire with seizures. And the people in the community were upset with the disciples because they could not cure the boy. Jesus comes down from the mountain. Jesus heals the young boy and sets him free. He cast the demon out of the boy. And when the disciples asked Jesus, why couldn't we cast it out? Jesus said, some of these things only come out by fasting and prayer. One of the reasons that even in our justice work that I call for us to go back to Sacramento, we're calling it, for those that aren't in the faith community, a hunger strike that some of us are going to launch in next week. But in reality, what God put on my heart was to call a solemn assembly of fasting. Because we don't need to try to intimidate Jerry Brown. Jerry Brown is not my enemy. The sheriff's department is not my enemy. I recognize who my enemy is. It's the same enemy that resisted the kingdom of God and the scriptures. It's the same enemy that resisted the way of God in the world. And we must fast and pray. Because there is a spirit of God that wants to exist inside of us, that will bring power to our words and power to our demonstration and power to our acts of justice and power to our acts of mercy. Without this power, we are simply disciples trying to cast demons out of people that we have not first cast out of ourselves. So Spirit, break out. I want you to get this in your mind. Spirit, break out.
Spirit, break out.
Walls so heavy can come down.
Heaven come down.
So it's for us to reclaim this idea that Jesus is an exorcist We like to talk about Jesus as a revolutionary. We like to talk about Jesus as a savior. We like to talk about Jesus as a messiah. But oftentimes what we miss is that Jesus was also an exorcist. He spent his ministry driving dark energy out of people. And a lot of us have gone through things in our lives that we have not yet allowed the Spirit of God to drive the remnants of that out. So we're trying to minister with gimpy legs. We're trying to move forward with a broken spirit. But God says, would you allow me to drive out of you the thing that is holding you back from moving forward into my destiny? Jesus crossed a stormy river in Mark chapter 5 to reach a boy who was trapped in the tombs with demonic energy. Jesus is an exorcist that calls us to combat this in ourselves. And James 4 talks about this need for us to resist the devil. He says, if you resist the devil, he will flee from you. You see, I believe, and I'm going to leave it up for how this says inside of us, but that God is calling many of us into a lifestyle of fasting. Let me break down for you what that means. It is a lifestyle of abstinence. You are not going to be able to flow in the Spirit of God doing whatever it is you want to do. But God says if you will abstain from the lust of the flesh, if you will abstain from what you have the right to do, but it is not profitable for your spirit, if you will abstain and give yourself over to be revolutionized by the Spirit of God, God says, I will give you power. The scripture says that when you receive the power of the Holy Ghost, he says you will be able to take up things that should harm you and they won't harm you. He says you will be effective and have the power to speak in new tongues. He says you will have the power to lay hands on those who are sick and broken and they will be healed. I believe that God is bringing a word to this house that if we will resist the evil inside, as we resist the evil outside, then God is going to cause a new emergence of kingdom living to happen in this place. The last point I want to share with us, and then even for those who are listening, I want to be inviting you. I want you to know where we're going. I want to invite you to ready yourself, because there's some of us who God has been speaking to your heart about calling you into deeper ways with him. But we haven't made the steps. We're going to be praying here a prayer of deliverance and a prayer of change. I believe the Holy Spirit is going to meet us for the few minutes that we have left to start a process. And moving forward, I also believe we're going to be calling some spaces where we're going to begin to start having some nights and some opportunities for us to meet with the Spirit of God. I'm telling you right now, if you will humble yourself under God's mighty hand, then God will exalt you at the right season of your life. 2 Corinthians says that the weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal. They're not physical. But they are mighty through God to the pulling down of enemy strongholds. Brother and sister, whatever has been existing in your life, I don't want to preach over it. I can give you some great points and schemes and strategies. I can tickle your intellect. But if you do not experience the move of the Holy Spirit of God, the mystical power of the Holy Ghost, If we are not ready to open up our minds and our hearts to say, God, impact me in ways that blow my consciousness, we will live life short from the promise of God. We must be filled with God's Spirit to get the hell out and bring the heaven in. So I want you to rest on your feet with me. For those of us who are here today, I don't know who should take, who would say, I need to be impacted by God. Not just because I've got challenges in my life or you know, I just want a blessing, but you know that God is calling me into deeper ways of being. That God is calling me to drive out some of the things I have been holding on to in my life, and that today will be the first day of a fresh commitment of abstinence, of faithful commitment to God. That today will be the first day of a fresh commitment to a lifestyle of prayer and fasting and sanctification and holiness. If you are willing to step forward and say that I want God to meet me in ways that maybe I've not had a container before to deal with, but God, if you want to come meet me, I'm ready to meet you. And if there's something you want to do in my life that's beyond what I've learned, that's beyond what I can control, Lord, I'm ready and I'm available to be a vessel of honor, to be a vessel of glory. If you're here, you say, man, I want God more than I want anything else. And I want you to come here and feel the altars, and we're going to pray for you, believing right now that God is going to move with a powerful anointing. If you're here in the room, I want you to come here.
Clap your hands, everybody. Give God a praise. Have your seats. Have your seats in your campus. And, you know, I love how God can give us what we don't know we need. Yeah. Oh, somebody shout hallelujah. Yeah. Some of y'all didn't even know you needed to get the hell out of here today, did you? Some of us, we're not even aware that there's hell in us, because, you know, we've gotten so in love with ourselves that none of us think we can do any wrong. But isn't it just like God to reveal some things to you, man? Some of you don't know what just happened today, amen. But that's okay. Because how many know God does things that you don't always understand? And I know, you know, we a lot of educated folk. I'm pretty educated. But the more I learn, the more I realize I don't know. And it don't mean that we're anti-intellectual. It just means that sometimes you gotta open yourself up to something you don't even know you need. And you may learn to like it. I remember one Christmas I was given a gift, and I thought it was going to be a transformer. It was a big transformer thing, and I mean just hugged that gift. It was wrapped, and I just was in love with it. And I was rocking back and forth, singing about my Metroplex. And when I opened it, it was a chemistry set. I was just so angry. I kicked that thing, you know. I think that was one of them times my dad did a laying on of hands. And I just stuck it under my bed. And I said, I'm not, you know, this ain't what I wanted. And one day it was raining outside, I couldn't go out to play, and I'm looking for new stuff to do, and I pulled that chemistry set out. I started to play with it, and I was like, wow. Turned out to be one of the best kids. I mean, that actually spurred me on to like try to pursue engineering before I flunked out in some babies. But that's what's the point? The point is, I didn't know that chemistry set was something I would fall in love with. But I thank God
my man. God puts other people in your life to introduce you to things that you never would take on your own. I just want you to know that, you know, this form of worship we just participated in today is very common in Pentecostal charismatic spaces. Some of us aren't exposed to that, exposed to this. But just be reminded that the overwhelming majority of the church's growth happening right now in this postmodern age is among Pentecostal charismatic Christians all over the world. So when I say I pray that we can be comfortable, I'm praying that we here in the Western U.S. church, we can be comfortable experiencing what God would have all to experience, regardless of your race, background, education, country of origin. Because as Ben said, man, there's some things that can only happen in you unless you do some different practices. And I pray and hope that this kind of engagement in the spirit, it felt like emotionalism to a lot of you, but that's all right. Now we know God gave you emotions. There's nothing wrong with you emotionally being engaged to worship God. Man, you get emotionally engaged to do everything else. Man, you don't be sitting there and looking at the football game just without emotion. You don't watch Scandal without emotion. You don't fight for justice without emotion. So why would you come into the house of God? Oh, that's emotionalism. Okay. But could you imagine that some of this emotionalism worship is actually setting right something inside of your emotional composition that the world has maybe set wrong? That's why, you know, we come out of these kind of traditions, and I think we need all of it. Give your neighbor a high five and tell them, I need all of it. I don't need just the part of God that suits me. I don't need just the part. I only want to do this part of Christianity because that's what I'm oriented to. You should want all of it. Drink from all the wells of Christian tradition. Drink from all of it. All of it will bless you. All of it will enrich your life. Amen. 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 Y'all hear me today. This is what the way is. This is the way. It is the way of Jesus. It ain't the way of the Catholics. It ain't the way of the Pentecostals. It ain't the way of the Baptists. It ain't the way of the Methodists. It ain't the way of the Quakers. It's the way of Jesus. And Jesus is in all that stuff. Somebody shout hallelujah. Amen. Let's thank God one more time for that great movie of God.